Do you know what source code, machine language, and assembly language are? Find out in this video. My name is Tim Bachalka from the Learn Programming Academy, and let's explore software now in more detail. In this video, I want to talk briefly about application software, often referred to as apps. This is the software that you and I utilize each day to accomplish whatever we want our computers, phones, or wearables to do for us. Literally, the sky's the limit to the variety of these apps. So let's take a look. All right, we're going to start out with a simple program called Hello World. So your boss has asked you to create an application program that just displays the greeting Hello World on his display monitor when he runs the app. So where do you begin? Well, hopefully you're familiar with the type of computer and operating system your boss is using, a Windows laptop, for example. Next, assuming you have complete freedom of choice for programming languages, you will more than likely pick the language that you're already familiar with, Java in this case, for example. So use a simple text editor program, you'd enter the following Java language commands as you can see on screen there. And I'm not going to go into the code there and explain it at this stage, that will happen later in this course. For now though, this is a very basic Java program that does display that output. Alright, so having typed that in, next you'd save this program as a Java program, naming the file you save it in as helloworld.java. You then quit the text editor, now it's time to compile your Java program. The computer doesn't understand your program source code, that text we saw on screen, and needs it to be translated or compiled into an intermediate language that can be understood and converted to machine language by the Java Virtual Machine, or just JVM software, which exists normally as a standalone program on your computer, but can also exist via a plugin in a web browser. So you start the Java compiler by giving a simple command, javac helloworld.java. So the Java compiler then converts your source code line by line into the intermediate language. Should the compiler identify any unknown programming statements by comparing your statements to the proper syntax of the Java language, it'll display one or more error messages on your display monitor. If you've got any errors, then you need to edit your helloworld.java program file again to correct the errors, then repeat the compile command above again. When the compiler doesn't find any errors, it'll create a file called helloworld.class. Now this is a file that you'd run on your boss's computer to have it display the Hello World text. So the final step is to run the compiled helloworld.class program. So all you need to do there is type Java Hello World and your program should start running and display the text Hello World on the monitor. Now that's all there is to creating a very simple application program. Now I'll move along now to say a few things about programming languages in general, followed by a brief discussion of compiled versus interpreted languages. Programming language history starts with zeros and ones. Programmers could only use the binary digits 0 and 1 to communicate instructions to the computer. Sounds simple. Yes, but in order to really have the computer do something significant via these zeros and ones, it'll take tons of them working together to accomplish the goal. The programming language that uses just zeros and ones is called machine language, and each line in the figure is called a machine instruction. In reality, computers only understand zeros and ones, so any instructions we give the computer must ultimately be converted or translated into zeros and ones. The computer is happy, so to speak, with zeros and ones, but humans are not. If every human had to only use zeros and ones to communicate with computers, it would create a serious shortage of human programmers who'd want to actually do this type of work. I surely would not want to do that. So computer scientists created the assembly language, which removed the tedious work of using zeros and ones. In its infancy, the assembly language was a huge improvement, but today it's considered a low-level programming language, even though it still has widespread use as a preferred language for creating operating systems and utility programs. Now, as you can see in the figure, assembly language consists of instructions that are mnemonic codes for corresponding machine language instructions. So these mnemonic patterns of letters you see are much easier for a human to remember than a bunch of zeros and ones. Even the use of mnemonics challenges humans and again limits how many humans would want to do computer programming using assembly language. Therefore, computer scientists created high-level languages such as we have today with Fortran and COBOL being some of the earliest ones. Common application programming languages today include Java, C, C++, C#, Python, Swift, PHP and JavaScript, just to name a small handful. Keep in mind that programming languages come and go, whereas some stick around for a long time, like Fortran and COBOL and C. Even Java has been around for about 25 years now. Many of today's programming languages, Java, C++, C#, for example, are examples of compiled languages. What that means is that the programmer writes the entire program or a subset of it, and then has a compiler program do a grammar syntax check on the program to make sure it conforms to the exact language structure, and then translates it either into an intermediate or machine language version of the program for the computer to actually execute. So it's a two-step process in a sense of writing the programming instructions, then seeing if they compile correctly. Integrated development environments, or IDEs, have very powerful compilers built in and are able to compile individual lines of code written by the programmer as it's keyed into the IDE's editor. This feature is extremely valuable to the programmer because syntax errors are caught in real time rather than after the program's written. The other type of language translator is known as an interpreter. Python is an example of an interpreted language in that the programmer can type a line of code, an instruction, and the interpreter will translate it and execute it on the spot. Another example of an interpreted language is the hypertext markup language, HTML. Each browser, Edge, Safari, Chrome, Firefox, etc., interprets and converts each individual line of HTML code as it's running in the browser. Pretty impressive. All right, so that's the end of this video on application software. Do you know how a programmer communicates in a program with memory or RAM? Find out the answer in the next video. Thanks for watching. See you in the next video. Alrighty, this is the part of the video where I'm meant to get all enthusiastic and to ask you, or quite literally beg you, to subscribe to my channel and to like the video, leave a comment and all that stuff. Well, I'm going to leave that decision in your capable hands to decide whether I've earned a like or a subscribe or a comment. I'd be grateful if you do one, both or all three. My videos will get out there and in front of a bigger audience if I get that level of engagement, but obviously it's your choice. Alright, so remember that this series was meant to be watched in order, so if you haven't watched from the start, then how dare you watch my video series out of order? Click the link over here to get to the first video in the series and watch that if you want to see the entire series in order. Or come over here and click to view the previous video in the series, again your choice. Alright, I'm done. Catch you in the next video.